I hope I will not speak too fast, that the translation will work, and I'm really glad to be here again. I'm grateful to you. I also admire Ediciones Akal and others who regularly publish my work here, and especially with you, you were, I can more or less, I understand Spanish, I follow what you said, and you know, I was almost like waiting, just good thing, then I was asking myself, but you must be sharpening your knife in the back of you, so where is, are you keeping this for questions to the end or whatever, you know? Because what I will say today, it will be more a political talk. What I will say today will be put in a very problematic way. I hope some of you will react even violently, because I really see our situation today as very controversial, in the sense of it's a paradoxical situation. In what sense? Let me begin with the title of my talk, A Plea for Bureaucratic Socialism. Now, your first reaction is, this must be another of my stupid postmodern jokes or paradoxes and so on. So I cannot emphasize enough that I mean this title in a totally positive, naive way. I think we have to reinvent bureaucratic socialism. Socialism which will be alienated, but alienated in the right way. What do I mean by this? Jean-Claude Milner reports that when he was young, he was sitting at a table with Louis Althusser, who once, in a coffee table debate, said something surprising and I think very intelligent. Althusser said that there are three types of revolutionaries: those who use old proverbs, those who use no proverbs, and those who invent or use new proverbs. And I think this is an excellent definition. For Althusser, for example, he noticed how Stalin from early 30s liked to use old Russian proverbs, old wisdoms and so on. How Robespierre mostly used no proverbs, another revolutionary figure, and how Lenin and Mao, even when they pretend to repeat old proverbs, they are really inventing new proverbs. And I agree with Althusser that this is the task of a true revolutionary. Why? Proverbs, they stand for accepted wisdom. And it's easy to overturn, to make fun of old proverbs. The really difficult thing is to invent new proverbs. What do I mean by this? The well-known Hollywood producer Sam Goldwyn, he was a genius, I think, for all his apparent primitivisms, nonsenses, but which we know today they were well planned. And one story about Sam Goldwyn is that he read in a newspaper some journalists criticizing films produced by his studio for using too many old clichés. And he immediately wrote a memo to his screenplay scenario department saying, we urgently need new cliches. And he was right. And that's what we need politically today. I'll present you quite brutally, naively. It will be a very naive talk, what I will do today. My thesis: I am sick and tired of revolutionaries or protest movements which focus on those ecstatic moments. Oh my God, 1 million people on Syntagma Square, on Tahrir in Istanbul, and so on. We were all so enthusiastic there, and so on, and so on. I'm not impressed by that at I think this is even relatively easy to do. The true test of a revolution or radical social change is how do ordinary people experience the change when the ecstatic moment is over, when things return to normal. That's the most difficult task. When nothing happens, when just everyday life is here, how is this everyday life different from the previous everyday life? Which is why I was never fascinated by all those comparisons between revolution and carnival. You know, Mikhail Bakhtin, the fellow traveler of Russian formalists, developed this point nicely on how, apropos François Rabelais, he developed this, how we have those wonderful moments in social life where social hierarchy disintegrates, a slave is a master is a slave, everything is turned around, there is sudden freedom, old rules no longer apply, and so on and so on. And some stupid leftists took this as a paradigm of the revolution. Now, my friend, I don't always agree with him, but here I do, Boris Groys, the Russian theorist working in Germany, told me a wonderful thing. Recently, they discovered some manuscripts of Mikhail Bakhtin in Kazan. Why? He was exiled there in the age of Stalinism. That's how he survived. And it's clear from those manuscripts what was for him carnival. It wasn't a liberating experience. The secret reference was Stalinist purges. This was for Bakhtin the true carnival. Today I'm a member of a central committee, tomorrow I'm prisoner in Gulag, and so on and so on. This total chaos in social hierarchy. So there is nothing subversive in it. The true problem, again, is not to say we need a release of fresh energy. Our life should not be ossified in fixed structures and so on and so on. No, it should be ossified, but in different structures. That's the difficult thing to do. It's easy to have, again, ecstatic moments of freedom. Oh, we are all free. Okay, we are free for 1 week, for 3 weeks, for 5 weeks, and then? And then? That's why, if you permit me to repeat an old joke of mine, that's why I find very problematic the film, which many leftists like very much, I don't, V for Vendetta, if you saw it. You remember the final scene? Wonderful, ecstasy, carnival. The crowd penetrates the police cordon, enters the parliament, people take over. But, as I like to say in my tasteless way, I'm ready to sell my mother into slavery to see a film called V for Vendetta Part 2. Okay, the people have won. What happens the next day? What new laws do they pass? How do they do it? How do they reorganize state apparatus, and so on and so on? So now I will go more in detail and in where I see the problem. And again, I am on purpose provocative. When one hears anarchists deploying their idea of local communities which work in a transparent way, with no alienated representative mechanisms, with all members engaged in organizing their lives, one should recall that their survival of these non-alienated local communities relies on a thick texture of alienated institutional mechanisms. Where do electricity and water come from? Who guarantees the rule of law? To whom do we turn for health care? And so on. The more a community is self-ruling, the more this network has to function smoothly and invisibly. So maybe we should change the goal of emancipatory struggles from overcoming alienation to enforcing the right kind of alienation. how to achieve a smooth functioning of alienated, invisible social mechanisms which sustain the space of our local non-alienated lives. You know, we all like this idea. We are a community, we debate all the time, but are we aware how many things must function in the background for this to be possible? And we have an old name for these alienated mechanisms, bureaucracy, which is why the left needs today to reinvent bureaucratic socialism. The standard characterization of Stalinist regimes as bureaucratic socialism, I think, is totally wrong. It is the way the Stalinist regime itself perceived its problems, the cause of its failures and troubles. Stalinists always claimed, if there are not enough products in the stores, if authorities do not respond to people's demands, and so on and so on, then they always blamed the bureaucratic attitude of indifference, and so on and so on. No wonder that from the late 20s onwards, Stalin was writing attacks on bureaucracy, on bureaucratic attitudes. But I think that paradoxically, what didn't function, it's not that Stalinism was too bureaucratic, it wasn't bureaucratic enough. Nothing functioned, bureaucracy didn't function, really. That's why Stalinism had to live all the time through an emergency state. Stalinism is for me precisely the failure of bureaucracy. What does this mean for our world today? What happened in Greece? How did we end up where we are today? And it's a very sad thing. Where are we? This is maybe the best indication of the confusion of our predicament. Hey, if you want today a minimal series of measures which, at least in some sense, they serve workers, workers' interests, students, and so on. Usually, it's quite often right-wing populist regimes who are the only ones who dare to do this. For example, in Poland, where you have the Kaczynski brother, Jan Kaczynski, one of the two, the other died, the de facto ruler of Poland. You know that now they enacted incredible set of reforms. They lowered retirement age, made it easier for students to get loans and so on, healthcare and all that. Only a radically right-wing nationalist government can do this. And on the opposite, isn't it sad that, if you want, the toughest austerity measures, the best one to do it is a radical left party in power. Just imagine if in Greece conservatives, New Democracy, were to remain in power. Syriza in opposition would have probably organized massive demonstrations and so on and so on. With Syriza doing the austerity measures, the demoralization is total. So what went wrong? I think that again, that great disappointment, you remember, on one day, 2 years ago, when Syriza won the referendum, surprisingly, for themselves. I know from Varoufakis that Tsipras was totally shocked. He wanted honorably to lose the referendum. They won the referendum, literally, one day later, they capitulated. I don't blame them. I'm not saying, the traitors, and so on. It's a real difficulty of the left today. Again, the difficulty of the day after. Okay, you triumph, referendum, but what to do the next day? So there is a narrative now emerging about Greece. The idea is that when Syriza was approaching power, the Tsipras leadership made a series of decisions, not only about the political party line, but also about the type of party they needed. They advocated the transformation of Syriza from a coalition of disparate organizations and civil movements into a unified, centralized party. The great number of members of its central committee made it sure that de facto decisions were made in advance in a narrow informal circle around Tsipras, the so-called paracenter of power. So it's easy then to claim that the problem of Syriza was that it became an alienated party elite running the state and that it lost contact with its social base, with civil movements, trade unions, protest movements, and so on and so on. And then the obvious solution is we should rejuvenate, reunite this basis in popular movements. But I think that this analysis is totally misleading. Where Syriza failed is not in simply accepting the logic of state and abandoning its roots in civil movements, but to find a new way how to reorganize the state. It's not enough to say we have to keep always the pressure of the people, presence of grassroots organizations, and so on and so on. Yes, but how? What does this mean for the state itself? How to reinvent the state itself? Because again, as all great revolutionaries, from Robespierre to Lenin and Trotsky, knew very well, you cannot maintain a permanent emergency state. Well, people have an attitude of permanent mobilization, we are always active, and so on and so on and so on. Again, the problem is how to do it when things return to normal, when people get tired of being permanently mobilized. Then you need, maybe not the state, we have it, but you need some alienated mechanisms, and I'm not afraid of liking them. Listen, now I will make a personal confession for which some of you will probably want to lynch me. Can you imagine me living in a small community where every afternoon we have to debate how we distribute water, how we how we do the kindergarten, care for the children, how this, how that? It would be hell for me. I want to live in peace. I want invisible. I want to live my life of reading books, watching movies, writing about them. And I simply want an efficient, invisible mechanism to take care of all that. And I don't think there is anything bourgeois or whatever in this. The challenge is to build this in a different way, outside the scope of capitalism and so on and so on. I will even go a step further here when we talk about popular pressure, popular mobilization. The long history of universal suffrage in the West shows that vast majority of the people is, as a rule, passive, caught in the inertia of survival, not ready to be mobilized for some cause. That's why every radical movement is always constrained to a vanguard minority. And in order to gain hegemony, it has to wait patiently for a crisis, usually war, which provides a narrow window of opportunity. In such moments, an authentic avant-garde, can seize the day, mobilize the people, and take over. And communists here, and I'm not criticizing them, I admire them, were always utterly non-dogmatic here, ready to parasitize on another issue. Remember that October Revolution gained support not with "we want socialism," but with "land and peace." Chinese Communist Party, its slogan was national liberation and unity against corruption. So communists were always aware that mobilization will be soon over, and they were carefully preparing the power apparatus to keep them in power at that moment. So this betrays another big problem of the Western Marxism. Where is the revolutionary subject? How is it that the working class does not complete the passage, as we say in Hegelian terms, from in itself to for itself? How is it that it doesn't constitute itself as a revolutionary agent? This is why, a very vicious remark, all Marxists really like very much psychoanalysis. Why? They claim we have the best theory that explains economic crisis and so on. But then this theory predicted the emergence of proletariat as a revolutionary agent, and then when you ask them, the communists, I am one of them by the way, when you ask them, but why is there no revolution, they say, to explain this we need psychoanalysis to describe the deep manipulation and so on and so on, whatever. For this reason, Western Marxism was also all the time in search of other social agents which could play the role of the revolutionary agent. Students, third world peasants, intellectuals even. And I think this is the lowest point, with all my support for refugees. This is why I find this horrible. Some of the leftists celebrate refugees. Why? Their idea is this one. We have good revolutionary theory. We just don't have revolutionary agent. Maybe if we import refugees, they will fill in this gap and we will be able to make a revolution in Western Europe with enough refugees. I find this obscene. It means like outsourcing the revolutionary subject, you know. We don't have a revolutionary subject, we will import it. Because of this situation, we are today in a unique predicament, which is really tragic. Namely, let me return to Marx. Marxism was right about the so-called final crisis of capitalism. We are clearly entering it today, I claim. If you look at the signs, all the problems we're encountering, ecology, refugees, biogenetics, financial capital, and so on and so on. My God, even official ideologists, like whom I really hate, I think they're more dangerous than Trump even. These pseudo-progressive liberal corporate leaders like, you know, Mark Zuckerberg, Elon Musk, and so on. This is the big slogan today. Capitalism is disappearing, and so on. They are right. But you know where Marxism obviously went wrong? The idea of Marxism was that when capitalism will be disintegrating, there will be another agent waiting to take over and bring capitalism to the higher stage. But today, and this was unthinkable for Marx, we only have disintegration. But no progressive force taking it over. Or to put it in another way, on the one hand, and this is the tragic split, on the one hand, we have all these protest movements against capitalism, against neocolonialism, against precarious workers, and so on and so on. Or protesting, COVID when you don't have jobs, joblessness. Sorry? Yeah. But you know what's so sad here? First, let me ask you a common sense question. I never understood it. Why are people afraid of robotization, that it will take them their jobs? Isn't this wonderful? We'll have to work less. Isn't this shows how deeply perverted our universe? Instead of saying, fine, work less, we see in this the extreme panic. Oh my God, we will lose our jobs. This is a very sad sign, which shows that the left really doesn't have a vision. So again, at the same time that we have all these protest movements, We have. They were described at different levels, and these descriptions are way too naive. I don't trust them, but nonetheless, like Paul Mason, Jeremiah Rifkin, and so on. They describe how capitalism is reaching its end, how through digitalization, market economy can no longer dominate the entire production, and so on and so on. But the, so really, we can see in these processes of digitalization, automatization, already the roots of a post-capitalist world. But no link between this and most, at least, of the protest movements. So let me quote you a German sociologist who wrote a wonderful collection of essays called How Will Capitalism End? Wolfgang Streeck, with two E's. Is it translated into Spanish? It's worth reading. Here is a quote from him. It is a Marxist, or better, modernist prejudice that capitalism as a historical epoch will end only when a new, better society is in sight, and a revolutionary subject ready to implement it for the advancement of mankind. This presupposes a degree of political control over our common fate, of which we cannot even dream after the destruction of collective agency. And indeed, the hope for it in the neoliberal globalist revolution. So again, the thesis of Streeck is, yes, capitalism is disintegrating, but according to Marxist doxa, this disintegration should be the very moment of the rise of a new revolutionary subject, which doesn't happen. I'm not saying this is a spontaneous process. The whole effort of today's ideology goes into what? How does ideology today function? It appears precisely as its opposite, as a radical critique of ideological utopias. I think that the predominant ideology today is not a positive vision of some utopian future, but a cynical resignation, an acceptance of how the world really is. The acceptance accompanied by a warning that if we want to change the world too much, only a totalitarian horror can be the final result. So, every vision of another world is dismissed as ideology. Alain Badiou put it in a wonderful and precise way. He wrote that the main function of ideological censorship today is not to crush actual resistance. This is the job of repressive state apparatuses, but to crush hope, to immediately denounce every critical project as opening a path at the end of which there is always something like Gulag. And this, let's call it post-ideological ideology, ideology whose entire identity is based on denouncing every progressive hope as ideology, this is how ideology functions today. And this functioning of ideology also accounts for some strange events taking place today. What do I mean by this? An old Chinese curse is, it's not really Chinese, it's just some Englishman, I spoke with my Chinese friends, some Englishman claimed that he heard it in China, but nobody knows about this in China, okay? It's that when you really hate someone, you tell him, may you live in interesting times. Because interesting times are, of course, the times of troubles, confusion, and suffering. And it seems that in some of our democratic countries, we are really witnessing now a strange phenomenon which proves that we live in interesting times. Did you notice how, for example, apropos Macron in France, a candidate emerges and wins elections, as it were, from nowhere, in a moment of confusion building a movement around his name. Both Berlusconi and Macron exploded like this. But what is this process a sign of? Definitely not a sign of any kind of direct popular engagement beyond party politics. On the contrary, we should never forget that such figures explode with the full support of social and economic establishment. Their function is precisely to obfuscate, mystify actual social antagonisms. People are magically united against some demonized fascist threat. This weird phenomenon is, I think, one of the visible effects of the long-term rearrangement of the political space in Europe. Today, we no longer have two big parties, as you also in Spain, you had them till some, I don't know when, 5-10 years ago. You know, left-center party, right-center party, and then you have some marginal parties, but basically the two parties replace each other. And all phenomena like Trump, like Le Pen, and so on, signal in this direction that this standard duality, moderate left, moderate right, is disappearing. More and more, one party presents itself as what some people call a radical center. It's the party of status quo, usually it's the party of global capitalism, but at the same time, socially very liberal. They don't have any problem with pride parades of gay people, with abortion and so on and so on. This is the establishment. And then against it we have anti-immigrant racism, populism and so on and so on. And you must have noticed what disappears here, a more radical left. We saw this clearly in the case of Macron in France. I was also one of the marginal victims attacked there because, while of course I agreed that Le Pen is a catastrophe, I just wanted to signal that Macron nonetheless stands for the establishment. He is the candidate of the establishment. And I find it very sad that, okay, it's nice to say we need anti-fascist unity against Marine Le Pen. But it's very sad to see a candidate of pure establishment. Don't have any illusions. The entire economic, ideological, journalist, TV establishment was full speed supporting Macron. And if you just hint at some critical point against him, what happened was that you were immediately denounced as objectively supporting Marine Le Pen. Some of my ex-friends in France even invented the term Le Pen-Trotskists, claiming that Mélenchon is objectively working for Marine Le Pen. How do these movements look? Already the names of these movements sound familiar in their empty universality, sorry, which fits everyone and everything. Berlusconi's motto was Forza Italia. With Macron it was La République en Marche. So they both designate just an abstract sense of victorious movement forward, without any specification of the direction we should pursue. Both movements exploded as reactions of the establishment in a panic. There is, of course, an obvious difference between the two, Berlusconi and Macron. Berlusconi entered the scene when, after the big anti-corruption campaign, the entire traditional political configuration in Italy collapsed, and ex-communists remained as the only viable force. So Berlusconi's mobilization was against what he perceived in the establishment as a communist threat. While Macron entered the scene when Le Pen's neo-fascist populism was perceived as a potential winner. Macron's role is best described by a word used by some of his supporters. In the last years, they claim, Marine Le Pen was gradually de-diabolized, perceived as part of the normal, acceptable populist political space. And the task is to re-diabolize her, to make her diabolic again, to show to the public that she is the same old anti-Semitic fascist, not to be tolerated by any serious Democrat. But I think such a gesture is not enough. It's not enough to re-diabolize Le Pen. If you want to be serious, we should do what the duty of the left is, to ask how a phenomenon like Le Pen was possible. What made it possible? It's clear what made it possible. The failure of the establishment, of the predominant hegemonic politics. So I think that when we have the battle like the one in France, Macron, popular unity against the fascist threat of Marine Le Pen, I think we should always ask ourselves, yes, but who is missing from the picture? A more radical left. And I think that the true task of Macron was not just to defeat Marine Le Pen, but to not just defeat, to make disappear a more radical leftist option. It's the same in United States even. I know what horror Donald Trump is, but I claim that the US Democrats diabolize Trump as the evil horror and so on in order to get rid of Bernie Sanders, who poses a threat to the Democratic establishment. This is why, although I don't doubt that there is truth in it, but this is why we witness in the United States this weird obsession of a Democratic Party with Russian hacking of the election. Probably there was some hacking, but nonetheless, the true failure was their own dismissal of Sanders. I claim Hillary Clinton lost because she got rid of Bernie Sanders' wing in her own party. And that's why you need Trump as a Russian agent, so that the image remains. We would have won, only we lost because of Putin and so on. In this way, we no longer have to ask critical questions, it's just the objective situation. Another thing that is part of this new space that is emerging, populism versus establishment, it's the saddest thing, maybe, I claim, is what some people call great regression, the rise of public obscenity. And here, Democrats in the United States were spectacularly wrong about Trump. Did you notice something so weird? How many times Trump said something which appeared catastrophic for liberals, and then there were predictions, oh, Trump just committed public suicide, he is out. You remember when his tapes were disclosed, where Trump is boasting how he was touching freely women between their legs, or when he made fun of the father of an American war hero and so on, all that. How they were wrong, the Democrats. They thought now he is finished. No, these apparent scandals just helped him. Why? Let's go to the end. Many of my friends even ask a question, how can a corrupted, lewd, destitute person, vulgar, like Donald Trump, the very opposite of Christian decency, how can he function as the chosen hero of the Christian moral majority conservatives? The usual answer that I hear is that they know what kind of a scum moral conservatives Trump is, but they care just about one or two points of his program. He promised to, for example, abolish or at least limit abortion. So they claim, we don't care. We know he is scum, what kind of person he is, but if he does this, limit abortion, It's a great thing, and of course some other things. But I don't think this is the case. I think that something more complex is at work here, for which we need psychoanalytic theory of identification. You know, when Trump made all these failures or mistakes, vulgar remarks and so on, brutal, almost openly racist, anti-feminist, at that point, people identified with him, because what do they see in Trump? A person who professes to be Christian high principles, but in reality he's a greedy, sexist, vulgar guy. But these are neoconservatives today. It is, they don't have to be disappointed in what Trump is. That's what they are. They identify precisely with both sides of Trump. So I think that, I don't have time to go into it now, that this should be a chance of the left today with people like Trump and so on. We should, the left should emerge, and I think, if I'm well informed, I don't know enough about you, that Podemos is trying up to a point to do this. Let's not leave to the right-wingers a nice term, there is nothing wrong in it, about moral majority. The only true moral majority is the left today. With figures like Trump and so on, it's over. And let me give you another example of this. Public figures of great morality, but where you see this other side of obscene vulgarity. A friend from Poland told me this, and I was shocked. Poland's de facto ruler, I already mentioned him, sorry, it's not Jan, Jarosław Kaczyński, made an interview in 1997 for the big liberal newspaper Gazeta Wyborcza, where, when he described how his party will take over, he used an incredibly vulgar exclamation, and he didn't disown it afterwards. He proudly insists on it. He exclaimed, in Polish, teraz kurwa my. It means, it's our fucking term. But I asked my Polish friends, and they claim that although the meaning of this phrase is, it's our fucking time, now we are in power, it's our term. But the literal meaning of this phrase is something much more vulgar. It's something like, now it's our time to fuck the whore. Like, you know, this vulgar lower class idea, a paid prostitute is slaying and we wait not to do a passion. Well, maybe, you never know where we are. No, but sorry. But yeah, we wait in Durham and you finish and then I say, it's my turn. But it's important that this phrase was publicly uttered by a devout Catholic conservative, protector of Christian morality. And again, I think this is precisely why people identify with him. It's not that people think he's a great moralic figure and then they're disappointed. My God, how? No. Both sides are part of the hegemonic ideology. Okay, just to amuse you a little bit, it's incredible how communists in power also are not far behind with similar vulgarities. For example, it will shock you, in his speech at the Lushan Party Conference in 1959, just when it became clear that things are not doing well with the fiasco of Great Leap Forward, that the result is mass hunger, millions dying, and so on, Mao called the party cadre to assume their part of responsibility. He said, you know, we failed with Great Leap Forward, millions of farmers are dying, we made serious mistakes, and he said that the greatest is my own responsibility, especially for the unfortunate campaign to make steel in every village. And then comes the surprise. This is not one hidden part in the middle. These are literally the last lines of his speech. The chaos caused was on a grand scale, the chaos of Great Leap Forward, and I take responsibility. Comrades, you must all analyze your own responsibility. Listen, if you have to shit, shit. If you have to fart, fart. You will feel much better for it. End of it. Now, why this vulgar metaphor? In what sense can the self-critical admission of one's responsibility for serious mistakes be compared to the need to shit and fart? I presume the solution is that for Mao, to take responsibility does not mean so much an expression of remorse, which may even push me to offer to step down. It's more that by doing it, you get rid of responsibility, so that no wonder you feel much better for it, like after a good shit. You don't admit you are shit, you get rid of the shit. I mean, that's the only way I can read. Are you aware of this utter vulgarity? When Mao is talking about his responsibility for death of millions, his metaphor for admission of guilt is like shitting, farting. Do it, you will feel better. Okay, here we are. So if you allow me nonetheless slowly to come to an end, so what can we do in this situation? Well, obviously, the world is becoming one. The functioning of our universe, where we have an inside and an outside. Because I think that films like Hunger Games, Elysium are basically right. This is the world that is slowly emerging. As a conservative, Peter Sloterdijk, but who I claim is not an idiot, nonetheless, developed, the metaphor for today's new world order is that it's global system, but global also in the sense of cupola, a globe, and we are inside, others are outside. The idea that we, the 20%, maybe 25 privileged, live in our safe space and we looked outside, and then refugees, of course, are those who penetrate this barrier, coming inside and so on and so on. This is one aspect. The other aspect which worries me today is we were so used when we were younger years ago to criticize Western neocolonialism, how the notions of human rights and so on are really Western imposition, falsifying local, imposing Western values on third world cultures and so on and so on. I think that something new is emerging now, which worries me much more. Phenomena like Modi in India, Putin, Erdogan, and finally Trump himself making pact with Saudi Arabia, even China and so on, demonstrate clearly that a new, genuinely multicultural, but multicultural in a terrible sense, order is emerging, where global market can be perfectly combined with each country or civilization living in its own secluded world. For example, that's why it was easy for Trump to make pact with Saudi Arabia and so on and so on. The West even resigned itself to accepting this. It's no longer the old naive Fukuyama idea, we have a vision, global democracy, we have to impose it onto the world. No, we can be good multiculturalists, to each country its own values, so while we can be feminists in our countries, we shouldn't mess with other countries if they do horrible things to women and so on and so on. In one of my recent texts, maybe some of you know it, I compared this to a strange phenomenon that I noticed with anti-Semitism. How today the latest form of anti-Semitism is Zionist anti-Semitism. I mean it quite literally. For example, you remember Breivik, the guy, the Norwegian crazy guy who shot 80 Social Democratic Young Kids there. He was a representative of this. He said, in Israel we should fully support the Jews. They protect us from Arab barbarism and so on. But not no Jews here. So here we are anti-Semitic, too many Jews and so on, Jews control too much England, America, but there we should fully support. And I think what is emerging now with Trump is something parallel, not just anti-Semitic Zionism, but Islamophobic respect for Islam. Look what Trump is doing. At the same time that he spreads this Islamophobic paranoia in the United States, he has no problem making deals with Erdogan, with Saudi Arabia, and so on and so on. So again, it's a new, totally cynical functioning of ideology, which makes critical job very difficult. You remember when American imperialism legitimized itself through human rights and all that? It was relatively easy for us, critics of ideology, but no, but you see, they are lying, their universality of human rights is a false one, it really privileges certain cultural features of Western white masculine culture and so on and so on. Capitalism today no longer needs this. What matters is universal market. What you do at the level of so-called human rights, it's your problem. So that's why, if you allow me some concluding remarks, which will be even more problematic for you, that's why, and a little bit of philosophy in it also, that's why it's crucial today to find the right formula for how to relate universal struggle for emancipation to the plurality of the ways of life. Because that's the problem today. We have some people even don't like the term way of life. They claim it already sounds of fascism and so on. But nonetheless, I think that why are so-called ways of life a fact? Because they are not just ways of life in the sense of abstract cultural identity. They are ways to organize, regulate our, and I use here this term in full, its full psychoanalytic Lacanian sense, our jouissance, excessive enjoyment. Enjoyment, if you allow me to improvise a little bit here, enjoyment is for me something, like for Lacan, very paradoxical. It's not the same as pleasure. Enjoyment is, even usually enjoyment in pain, enjoyment is how through pain you deal with pleasure. Let me give you, if you allow me, let me be present. No, don't tell a madman like me, just go on, because then you are lost. Okay, so, did you read in your newspapers, it was probably reported, I checked it up with my friends in Mexico, and Mexico is a wonderful country, strong progressive movements, I'm not against it, I'm talking about specific examples. In some small city, they want to be, not politically correct, but, you know, they want to unite with traditions, I mean, their ancient wisdom, indigenism. So, when you have minor crime acts, they don't simply leave it to state legal system. They have some local reunions of old wise people who know old indigenous rules, and they pass the judgment. So a struggle happened when an older guy raped a young girl. And there was a problem because these wise old people, well versed in indigenous justice, passed a judgment and condemned the old guy, and the punishment was to buy to the father of the girl, a pack, 12 bottles, a pack of cans of beer. And the feminists exploded and so on, but the judges said, sorry, this is our old justice, this is our traditional way of life. And I think it's too easy to trying to find your way out here. Because I try to reconstruct. Let's go a little bit more into this, because I don't tell you jokes and politics. What was the judge's reason? Okay, the judge was corrupted. He was paid. Because there is another case which is even worse, a similar one. A group of young people raped a girl. And one of them was pardoned by the judge. It was corruption, but the reasoning is interesting. One of them was pardoned by a judge because no facts were disputed. He admitted. But he claimed, I'm not guilty because I didn't sexually enjoy it. So he admitted. He, in a vulgar way, squeezed the breasts of the girl, pushed his fingers into her vagina. But he said, but I didn't penetrate her. I wasn't aroused. I didn't enjoy it. And the judge said, no, then you are not guilty. It's, I think, how to read this, because in my naive, some feminists may accuse me here, but I'm very naive here. Although, if he enjoyed it sexually while raping the girl, it's also, it has to be harshly punished. But I think, for me at least, it's just a tiny bit worse if you didn't enjoy it. Then, my God, why did you do it then? Obviously, just out of evil, to hurt her or to impress your colleagues or whatever. So I claim the premise of the judge was you can be only guilty if you enjoyed it. So enjoyment as such is, or pleasure, sexual as such is sinful, makes you guilty. No enjoyment, no guilt. But I think we should push this even a step further. It's not enough to say no enjoyment, no guilt. We should even say no guilt, no enjoyment. That's the perversity of some type of Catholic morality. If you just do it innocently, you make love, it's pleasurable. But it's not real intense enjoyment. To really enjoy it, you must feel guilty. Here things get so complicated, and I think to analyze all these paradoxes, it's crucial to understand the deadlocks of our consumerism or whatever. For example, something strange happened recently. A friend of mine from the United States told me he observed a strange phenomenon when he entered a Walmart megastore. It was towards the end of the working day, and when he exited the store, he saw many of these shopping carts full of stuff, but abandoned there. And he asked the seller there, what's going on? And the seller said, these are the newly impoverished middle classes who no longer can afford buying commodities there. So they just, as afternoon amusement, they go to the mega store, put things in the cart, and then leave it there. And just like, this is a nice example of pure surplus enjoyment without pleasure. That's what Lacan means by surplus enjoyment. Enjoyment in a way, enjoyment in procedure itself. The process itself provides enjoyment. And our sexuality is always characterized by this paradox. Let me give you another example. My good friend, the British Lacanian, half Kleinian, okay, psychoanalyst Darian Leader, told me a wonderful anecdote. One of his patients told him of his patient's wonderful slip of tongue. He wanted to seduce a lady, so he took a lady to a nice restaurant which was part of the hotel. Of course, the idea was, I will first invite her to a nice dinner and then suggest, why don't we go to a room upstairs? But he made a mistake. In entering the restaurant, instead of saying, a table for two, please, he said, a bed for two, please. Now comes the correct interpretation. It's not that his mind was already at sex. Daniel Leader guessed in a wonderful way that it was the exact opposite. He was afraid that he will enjoy too much eating and that he will forget where is the true duty, you know. So it was more to remind himself, be careful, don't enjoy here too much. And this eating in this sense is what Lacan calls objectit A, object small a, the surplus enjoyment. That it's necessary, like if you directly make love, if you directly go to sex, it wouldn't have worked. You need the obstacle.